Well, we'll be going to places near and far. That's our next programme this afternoon. It follows in a minute. Just before Near and Far, we have an important announcement regarding changes next term.
There's an important move coming for BBC Schools programmes. From next term, they'll be on BBC Two, and there are slight changes to the way we'll be starting them. Before the programme begins, you'll see a Follow Shortly slide like this. That'll be for at least 30 seconds, and often much longer. Then, a new daytime version of the BBC Two symbol will appear. That means it's exactly 10 seconds to go. When necessary, we'll make special announcements over this slide, just before the programme begins. Otherwise, it's time to watch.
Watch!
Once again, the sequence is Follow Shortly slide for at least 30 seconds, then the BBC Two symbol with exactly 10 seconds to go, special announcements over this, or straight into the programme. Remember, a new sequence and a new channel. Schools are on BBC Two from next term, so watch out.
This is a grassland in East Africa, an open, flat landscape with very few trees. It's called the savanna. Growing in the savanna are tall, wild grasses. They cover more land than any other plant in the world. These grasses feed the enormous variety of wild animals which graze on the grasslands. But it's not just wild animals which eat this grass. These cattle belong to one of the local nomadic tribes, the Maasai. They follow their herd around as it grazes on the savanna. These people live entirely on the milk, meat, and blood of their cows. The Maasai have altered their way of life to suit the eating habits of their cattle. They have also helped to alter the appearance of the savanna. At the end of every summer, they set fire to the old dry grass. They do this to clear the way for the new tender shoots to come through in the spring. The new shoots provide food for their cattle, while the ash that results from burning helps to fertilize the soil. Trees are burnt as well, adding to the open flatness. The new growth that this seasonal burning encourages not only provides food for the Maasai's cattle, the wild animals benefit too, the new growth arriving as the young are born. There are grasslands all over the world, but they're not all used in the same way. In Australia, the grassland runs in a narrow strip around the coast. Here, as in Africa, animals feed on the grass. Instead of grazing over large areas, the animals, mainly sheep, are kept in fields. Australia is well known for its wool and meat, and a healthy sheep can fetch a good price. Once bought, the new owner marks his sheep. Argentina is known for its beef. The cattle there graze on grasslands known as the pampas. But some of the pampas have been fenced off. Fields are used for growing crops, mainly wheat, a special kind of grass. It's not surprising this grows well, as the natural plant life here is grass. All the world's grasslands are a major source of food, whether it's grain or livestock. This is particularly true in North America. So important are the grasslands here that over 100 years ago, fierce battles were fought between the Red Indians and the white man over who should own the grasslands. This is the land they were fighting about. Grasslands known as prairies. Too dry for there to be many trees or bushes, but not dry enough to be called a desert. The natural cover of short grass and other plants fed the herds of buffalo, which the Indians hunted for food. They also used the skins of the buffalo to make tents and clothing. The white man wanted the land to graze their cattle, but there wasn't enough grass for both of them. It was the Indians who lost and were driven away. The cowboys travelled over enormous distances with the herds, living in the open and sleeping on the ground wherever the cattle grazed. It wasn't long before other white men came out to farm the grasslands. Unlike the cowboys who roamed with their cattle, these people came to settle. Because there were few trees on the plains, the settlers built their houses from turves. Thank you. It wasn't an easy life trying to plough the dry, hard soil, and with few trees it was difficult to fence off the land. A big change in the use of the grasslands came with the invention of barbed wire. Now they could build fences. This meant they could keep the grazing cattle off their land, which could now be used for a different purpose. Huge areas of grassland were ploughed up and sown with wheat. Years ago, there were already machines being used to harvest and thresh the wheat, although they were still pulled by animals. It wasn't long before the animals gave way to steam. Then came motor-driven tractors. The machinery grew larger and larger, and more powerful, and the fields got bigger and bigger. The fields became so big that in some parts of America, the wheat seems to stretch forever in all directions. Today, machines like these are used so that vast areas of grain can be cut as quickly as possible. In the colder northern areas of America, they grow a kind of wheat which is too moist when it's first cut to be gathered right away. So the harvest takes place in two parts. First, the wheat is cut, the flat paddles pushing the wheat against the blades of the cutter. After the wheat is cut, the machine lays it out in rows to dry. It's left for several days, the rows of drying wheat making strange patterns on the landscape. The farmer thinks the grain is dry enough, he uses another machine to collect it. This machine is called a thresher. It separates the grain from the husks of the plant. Together with the stems, the husks are returned to the field, while the grain is collected in bins on the machine. When the bins are full, the grain is transferred into trucks. To speed up the whole operation, this can be done while the thresher is moving along. In the warmer southern parts of America, they grow a different kind of wheat. This wheat is dry when it's ripe, so both harvesting and threshing can be done at the same time. The machine which combines both operations is of course called a combine harvester. Once it is time to harvest, speed is important. So many combine harvesters may be brought in to work together. The reason for the rush, the weather. The price a crop will fetch depends on how ripe it is, and that depends on the weather. The autumn, when the grain is ripening, can be a very nerve-wracking time for the farmer, particularly in the more northerly grasslands. The dark clouds mean less sun to ripen the crop. Worse than that, they might be bringing hail, which can flatten whole fields of wheat, damaging the growing plants. Another worry for the farmers in these parts is snow. If the snow comes early, it can ruin the entire crop. In the warmer grasslands, they have the opposite problem. It can be too dry, and you can never be sure when the rain will come. Some years it doesn't come at all. 50 years ago, this was an Oklahoma farm, but several years of drought and bad farming made it look more like a desert. With no grass or other plants to hold the topsoil down, it began to blow away. This became an area known as the Dust Bowl. Fortunately, that's all in the past, but living in the grasslands still presents other challenges. These children are going to collect the post. Their front drive is so long that they have to drive to the post box. Children are allowed to drive in this part of North America as long as they stay on these tracks and not on the main roads. They have to drive. The farms here are so big that people may live many kilometers from the main roads and from their neighbors. To get to school, buses are provided, but parents have to pay for that. Buses travel along a network of roads, linking all the farms in the area together. The farms are few and far between, and the roads are long and straight, running between the vast open wheat fields. This network is also used by the farmers to take their grain to the local storage depot. There it'll be weighed and tested for ripeness, and that determines the price it will fetch. From the depot, it travels by train and boat to all parts of the world. This is the market where the grain is bought and sold. Because everybody would like to buy the best grain, the bidding is keen. Most of the grain will be turned into bread, food for millions throughout the world.
I said, yes, yes. So I went to a studio for a year, and he used to...